Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome VP and Managing Director, Europe, Middle East, and Asia, Booking.com, Andrea D'Amico, in discussion with Skift Senior Research Analyst, Wouter Gertz.
Thanks, everyone, for coming back. Hopefully you had a good lunch, had a good workshop.
Not too heavy, hopefully.
Not too heavy, yeah. No itis, no after lunch dips. So before we start, once again, and I'm sure you have lots of questions for Andrea, so I probably don't even have to mention this, but Slido, we're still using it, so please put your questions into the in the app in the feature, in the Q&A feature, or go to slido.com and enter hashtag Skift Forum. So sitting next to me is Andrea D'Amico. He has been part of a lot of different iterations of booking.com, as I understand, for 15 years. He's currently the vice president and managing director for Europe, Middle East, and Africa. You joined the company, I know, before it was bookings.nl, before anything really, in Cambridge, if I understand correctly, before it was bought by Priceline, which is now obviously Booking Holdings. Before that, you were with veneer.com, again, so you've been in this industry for a very long time. Veneer, for those of you who are not aware, used to be part of Expedia, basically shut that down, I think, a few years ago. And you've worked throughout the world, which is interesting as well. I saw on your resume that you've worked in Asia Pacific for 3 years in Singapore. And I kind of wanted to start there and just ask, I've noticed that Booking Holdings, the mothership, I suppose, you've invested a lot in Asia Pacific. Didi, you've bought Hotels Combined. Is there anything that's coming from Asia that we should be aware of here in Europe? Should we be scared of what's coming from Asia, or do you think that's a different market and those players won't be branching out to Europe?
No, I think that there is no reason to be scared because, of course, these regions also represent a big opportunities for Europe and the other markets. What is really interesting about the Asian market is that it has been growing very fast, consistently through the years, and this is still the case. And basically, the trends that we see in markets like China are also a preview of what we are going to see in other regions. That's why working to find solutions for customers in these geographies is very important, because that can be also applicable to customers in other geographies in the future. Just to give you some examples, for example, the young middle classes in China skipped completely the desktop, so they do everything through mobile, everything to messaging. I think, if I'm correct, 95% of the searches on the internet in China happen through mobile. And also personalization represents a big topic there. So I think last year Alibaba shared that I think 50% of their business comes through personalization. So customers in those parts of the world are not really used to go on search engines and look for a product or services that they are interested in, but they're there waiting for you to reach out to them. So that's why I think Booking.com, but any other player in the e-commerce space, is working more and more with artificial intelligence, machine learning, in order to reach out to customers proactively. And I think that is, let's say, a direction that will work not only for China, but also for the rest of the globe. As you mentioned, we have been investing quite a lot. So I was in Singapore 2010 and 2013, and this is also when we started to also to add more offices. We went from 2 to 20 in these 3 years, but of course much more happened since then. So as you know, we have a good relationship with Ctrip, so basically both companies have access to to the inventory. So Chinese customers traveling outside China, they can book our accommodation. In the same way, we also offer our customers C-trip accommodation when we see that they have better availability or better rates. We also made some investments in Didi and Grab, because we are also moving more and more into transportations. And of course, it's very interesting for us to offer our customers the possibility to book transportation with Didi in China, with Grab in Southeast Asia, and at the same time also to make our brand more known to their customers as well. And also to learn from them on how to be more and more relevant for that kind of customer. So there is a lot that is happening. There will be much more coming. Also, of course, there is also competition that is coming from Asia. Of course, C-Trip is a partner, but it's also a competitor. Agoda is part of our family, but also the businesses are run independently. So, of course, if you have a strong customer base in Asia, you definitely have a lot of opportunities to be relevant also in the rest of the world. So I expect that they will get more more tractions, but tourism is a, let's say, $1 trillion industry, so I think there is room for everybody. So our approach has always been to look at competition, but more important to focus on what we are doing.
Cool. You mentioned a few very big players, obviously, there. You mentioned Alibaba. The one you didn't mention was Google. I'm sure everyone here wants to know a bit more about that. Your Booking Holdings CEO has made a few comments, I think, over the last couple of years about wanting to reduce marketing spending. I looked at the figures. You spent $3.8 billion in 2016 on marketing, $4.1 billion in 2017, $4.4 billion in 2018. So it's continuously going up. Yeah. And most of that, and you even say that in your reporting, is on Google. So will you ever be able to basically reduce spending on Google, do you think?
Yeah, so we don't have this this goal. So our approach to marketing spend is that we are happy to keep investing in every demand channel that is bringing us new customers at a good ROI. So Google, in particular, has been a tremendous partner for us. Basically, we are working with them, I think, for over maybe 15 years. I mean, when I was there, when I started working at Booking, we already had a good relationship. I think we learned maybe better than anyone else on how to use paid advertisement and also to increase our customer base. And we really had, I think, kind of symbiotic relationship with them, sharing a lot. We also learned a lot in terms of how they operate their business, how to make sure that they always meet the needs of their of the users. So as I said, they have been fantastic partners, and we think that this will be the case also for the future, as long as, of course, we are able to get from them new customers that otherwise we would not be able to get directly, and also that the ROIs are good. So basically, we look at every demand channels in the same way. I think it's our relationship with Google might be similar also to the relationship that we have with some of our big partners, right? With the hotel. So everybody would like to have only direct customers. So we will also love to have every customer to type booking.com directly and come to us, but simply it's not possible, right? So you also need to pay other demand channels in order to get these customers, and hopefully they will experience a great service when they are on your platform, and next time they will come directly.
But you're obviously a massive player in the industry. Google is a massive player. So I guess that relationship is sort of balanced out a little bit. Do you have any advice for players that might be here today, people that might be here today who might not be working for a big company like Booking.com, and how to deal with, because I think a lot of people will be looking at Google as a threat, or at least they look at it uneasily on what is Google going to do next. So do you have any advice on how to deal with Google?
Yeah, so I think if we look at the threat, of course, this is a question that has been popping up for many years, of course, because they are trying to engage with their customers in the travel segment at different levels, and that, of course, makes perfectly sense. That is part of the game. What the advice is, I think, in terms of Google, is also to understand. For your business, what is basically the value that they're bringing, what is the return on the investment, and always benchmark basically what is the return on other initiatives that can be direct brand advertisement or can be also used in different channels. So I would say that the best approach is always to try, let's say, everything, and then at the end also to measure and benchmark between channels to see what is the right distribution. So for some businesses, it might make perfectly sense to basically rely completely on Google. For some other businesses, might not be relevant at all. I think for most cases, it would be something in the middle.
Cool. And I know that Google has been, not to harp on about them, but I know that they've introduced or increased their searchability of vacation rentals, and I know that's a very important space for you as well. So could you share some figures maybe with the audience on how, because I think obviously globally it's very important, but how important are vacation rentals to you in Europe, and why are they so important for you in terms of growth?
Yeah, we start with this second question. So as you might know, our mission is to empower people to experience the world. And of course, accommodation plays an important part in this. So we want that customers coming on booking.com, whenever they want to go, wherever they want to go, whatever the kind of accommodation they want to stay in, they will find the right solution on booking.com. That's why in the past years, we started to scale up also this segment. I think last week we also released that since 2007 we had three billion guest stays on Booking.com, and $750 million was in homes, apartments, and unique places to stay. So I think a lot of people, maybe now it's not the case anymore, but I think in the past didn't really know that Booking was also offering different kind of accommodations. Booking has always been linked to hotels only, but today we also saw that there was a strong benefit in offering customers different types of accommodation. We have, I think, around 30 on one platform, because this is also bringing value to the hotels. This is something that we believe. So on the main figures, I think I shared basically what was our history with them. Last year, we also shared that we have, I think, 28 million listings, of which 5.7 million are in alternative accommodation. Of course, these are global numbers, but you can always refer to Europe as being, let's say, the biggest chunk of this segment and our business in general, because of course this is also where we started. Something that is interesting also to note is that last year, I think 40% of our customers booked one alternative accommodation. So it means that there is a lot of appetite for this kind of segment. It's growing faster than the rest of the business. And the good thing is it also is nicely profitable already. So that will allow us to keep investing in it.
Okay. And another area of interest that I know that Booking.com is looking into a lot is experiences or excursions, tours, activities, however you want to call it. Yeah. Last year on stage in Berlin, we had Pepijn Rijvers, your CMO, talking about at that point recent acquisition of Fair Harbor, and how important that aspect is to your business. I think it's gone a bit quiet around what's happening with Fair Harbor. Maybe that's not a fair thing to say. Maybe you don't feel that way. But could you just tell us a little bit more about where you are in that space?
Yeah, so of course, as I said, we started from accommodation, but in helping customers to experience the world, of course, we need to offer them everything. Right? So it goes to attractions, it goes to transportation, restaurants, shopping deals, any kind of service that they want to use through our platform. So we really want to interact with them, not only when they're booking their trip, but also when they are already at location. So I can mention I think some figures about our attraction products. So today we have attractions and experiences in over 120 destinations. Of course, also Fair Harbor is playing a part on this. So this is, let's say, is one of the technology solutions that we have in order to help our experience and activities partners to basically to have less pain point on the operational side, but also to have a better commercial framework to make sure that their offering is also fitting their the marketplace. So Fair Harbor has a great wealth of experience in every kind of activities, where it is a surf school, and where they need also to time their lessons in the perfect way in order to accommodate for the shifting tide, or I don't know, it can be knife sharpening workshop in Tokyo. Basically, they know exactly what they need to do. So Fair Harbor is growing at the pace that we are expecting. We are very pleased with this acquisition, but as we also do with other kind of businesses that then joined our group, we also make them run their business independently. And I think that is also one of the secret of the of the success in this domain. So I think it's going well, though maybe you don't hear any big announcements, but it's just because for us now it's business as usual.
Okay, cool. And then I guess we haven't really touched upon hotels yet. Obviously, it's a very interesting topic. I think here in the UK, quite recently, a couple of months ago, OTAs were slapped on the wrist for misleading discount claims and pressure selling. I know that in other European countries you've had some issues around rate parity and the clauses that you put into your contracts, which you aren't allowed to do anymore. I saw that on your Booking Suite product, the rate manager was closed down last year because of there was no sustainable demand, according to the company. So I'd just be interested to know a little bit more about, you talk a lot about hotel partners, but it doesn't seem to really work. I don't know where the partnership is. Can you just give your opinion on that?
I think it works pretty well, otherwise I would not be here. I think overall what I can say about, hotels, although of course we talk about homes and apartments, restaurants and transportation, hotels stay at the core of our business, of our operations. Basically, they are the main focus of our people. So basically, as you know, I mean, today hotels have a big variety of ways to get customers, right? So they can do it directly, they can do it with offline operators, they can do it online. And when you look at online, there are different platforms they can use. So basically, whatever you have done in the past so far, every day you start from zero. You start from zero with your partners and you start from zero with your customers. So every single day we need to work hard to make sure that we stay relevant to them and stay, I think, as the most effective way for them to attract new customers. Because the day that we will not be able to do that anymore, I think will be also a day where you will not see me on stage anymore. So I think that, of course, there is, because of also of our size, I think it's quite normal that sometimes we have also discussions with them. We have different points of view. We have we might have also disagreements, but that is, I think, the nature of every business relationship.
Cool. Final question for me before we'll go to some Slido questions. So if you have any questions, please put them in now. The title of the conference is Defining the Future of Responsible Travel. I know that Booking has their Booking Lab, Booster Lab, sorry. I think you've just announced or you're looking through some of the latest applicants. So can you explain a little bit more to the audience what is Booster Labs and what are the interesting things that you're seeing that are coming out of that?
Yeah, so the Booking Boosters is an initiative where we are going to fund and support innovative startups that are really making a change in the sustainable travel. I've been part of this program and the jury for, let's say, the 3 years that we have been running this program, so I'm very proud of it. So now we have the third round of startups. I think we have 10. They are, as we speak, in Amsterdam. So they spend, I think, 3 weeks interacting with different people in our organization to understand a bit more how we were able to grow our business, and they can see basically what are the tips that can work for them. And then at the end of the program, we also decide to give a grant to, let's say, to these companies. Just to give you some examples of recent startups that we had in our program, last year we had the Himalayan experience. So basically what they do, they bring solar power lights into remote villages in Himalaya through tourists. And another one, very nice, is also Women on Wheels. Basically, it's an Indian startup that is allowing local women to get a driving license to become cab drivers. And I think in this way, they also make them independent economically, and they give them, I think, also a very strong dignity. Mm.
Yeah. Amazing. Let's go to some questions. So the top one is, what's next for Booking.com in the digital space? As you've always been ahead when it comes to the ease of booking user experience.
Yeah, I think that what is the big next thing, but it's already here, and I think it's really new to the audience, because every company in the e-commerce is working on it, is really artificial intelligence. So in the travel, we work in an industry which is extremely emotional, personal, and complex. And I think artificial intelligence can play a big role into enhancing the search, book, and enjoy process. That's why we are more and more investing in it in Booking.com, and that is also very related to what I said before with regards to attractions, because what we want to do is to ensure that when you are at the destination, we make it easier for you to understand what are the activities that you can do, because we know exactly based on your preferences and what is available at destination, what can be the best use of your time. Or to give you another example, I think maybe those of you who use Booking.com in the past, we also have the Booking Assistant chatbot. Is able to handle, I think, 60% of the thousands of the inquiries that we get every day from partners and customers. And when they don't know the answer, they always refer to either the partner or to the customer. So it's basically we are trying to develop this assistance to be able to tackle not only one of two inquiries, but every kind of queries that might come. And we also make it available not only in English, but also in French, German, Spanish, Japanese, and Chinese. So I think that is, let's say, the next big thing. Of course, it's still a long way to go, but the potential is huge.
Okay. And I like the second question. Are there any plans to launch Booking.com own brand hotels or white label certain hotels or anything like that?
Yeah, that has been a discussion that, I mean, an idea that is popping up every now and then. I don't think that we will ever do it. I think first, because then we might create also some kind of conflicts with our partners, right? If we have our Booking.com hotels, you might always think that basically they get better conditions or an advantage towards the others. And the other one is that we all also prefer to focus on what we think we are good at. So we are not good at basically managing or operating hotels. We are, I think, good at sending customers to this hotel. So I think there is still a lot that we can do there, and this is where we should focus.
Okay. I think let's go to Paul, who's clearly very frustrated. When will you stop asking me if I want to go to Amsterdam again? So I guess it's about personalization. So it's the third question down. It's about business travel, Paul's saying. So, and understand my business drivers.
Amsterdam is a beautiful place, so I promise that once you have been there, we will stop. No, jokes aside, I think that we still have some work to do in order to make sure that also the recommendation that we give to our customers are relevant, because at the end, if what we are sending is not really of use, you will also stop, looking at it. So what I can say, feedback taken, if it's not relevant for you, it means that we haven't done a good job.
Yeah.
Simple as this.
Okay. I think the Fair Harbor question, we've touched upon that already. So one final question, how do you compete with Fliggy, which is one of the main players in China? Hopefully, having been in Singapore, you know.
Yeah, I might not be completely up to date there, but I believe we have also a partnership with the Fliggy. They have a huge store. So what we do is that, of course, we always try to develop our own products, but there are also big players already in China. And where possible, we always try to partner with them and also to get some share of their customer base also on, on their benefit. So I guess this is where we are at with Fliggy.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Andrea.
Thanks
for everyone.